Hello and welcome back to the Play It Forward podcast presented by PeacePlayers, the podcast where we lift up voices and stories of people working in their communities and networks to promote peace and equity. I am your host, Chinny Nwagbo, and I'm excited to be here today. If you can't see, I'll give you a visual. And Emmett is nodding his head and he has a brilliant hat. Just to celebrate the holidays. And we are excited about today's show. We're always excited about the show, but this one in particular is very special. And that being said, on today's episode, we will be speaking to our special guest on a Christmas movie called Klaus. Consider this our very warm and bubbly holiday bonus episode.
Yes.
We are excited to bring in the season. But before we do that, I've got to introduce the most handsome, you're also handsome too, Tim, man in the world, and brilliant co-host, Emmett Shepard.
Oh, guys, stop, guys. Yeah, you thought you could get rid of us? We're giving you a bonus episode. Two in one week, people. Happy holidays.
Yeah, happy holidays.
You know, it's a problem, Chinny, because you say you introduce me as the incredibly attractive and handsome, but really with Tim in the room,
yeah,
it's Tim, like, you know, it's like I'm barely scratching the surface of like subpar average looks. And so I appreciate your sentiment, but really, truly the most attractive man here is Tim. Yes, but hello everyone. I am Emmett, the incredibly and somewhat tall, I guess. I don't know.
Very tall.
Co-host to the beautiful Chinny Nwagbo. And
thank you.
As you can see from my Santa hat, I'm extremely excited about the holiday season. I hope you guys are as well. And Chinny, tell us who the hot guy is in the room right now.
All right. Evan, thank you for the handoff. He's an old friend of the show. That's right, folks. For our holiday bonus episode, we have the most brilliant Mr. Tim Rasmussen. Did I get it right? Thank you. That's right. As a reminder, he is the host of not one, but two podcasts and has a master's in peace transformation, which is pretty dope. He has also been involved in some monitoring and evaluating for peace players and is our first reoccurring guest. Give it up.
Wow.
He's also a brand new job that he can tell us more about in the coming minutes. Hopefully he has great news to share, but please help me welcome Tim Rasmussen.
Thank you. Wow. I come in here. I'm just feeling just honored to be with such good looking people. And also to be back, you know, I always say, you know, just like Star Wars, any good franchise needs a cheesy holiday special.
Yeah.
And yes, they do. Yes, they do.
I'm so glad I can be a part of this one. Yeah. It's truly an honor. And yeah, I'm just happy to be here. I'm feeling merry.
Yes.
And joyful.
Yes. Joyful
and merry. You know, the problem is for the next 40 minutes, we're not even going to talk about the movie. We're just going to be talking about how good we all look. That's pretty much what the bonus episode is.
You know, sprinkle a little holiday season in there, literally.
Before we dive into the movie, as you know, and I know you've told your students this as well, because, you know, big news travels fast.
Absolutely.
I'm considered the icebreaker king. And it's not a title that I've given to myself. This is just something that I was born with. I can't control it. It's spreading like wildfire, you know? Yeah.
Royal blood.
Yes, royal blood at the end of the day. And so for today's icebreaker that I'm asking you, I was wondering if you had a billboard that millions of people could see every day, what would be your billboard?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. You are the icebreaker king.
He is.
I don't need to be here anymore.
That's a brilliant question. What would I want everybody to see?
Besides your handsome face, of course.
Yeah, obviously. It could just be.
I mean,
we'll have to include that
on the billboard. Just kidding. You put me on the spot like this, it's really hard.
No.
Yeah. I feel like I would want to do something that was just really reflective, like something that just that just invited people to do some reflection, or maybe even something that was just like a really gentle but like very casual nudge for people, just something that just said like, keep it real, you're awesome, or something like that. Just to make people feel good about who they are, or to make them reflect on who they are. Either way, something like that.
Yeah. And what's the color scheme there? Yeah, what are you thinking?
You know, I have an affinity for just like something that's that has kind of an urban, kind of like a skater look, maybe like some graffiti type art. That just kind of it's loud, but it's also it looks accessible. Maybe it, you know, something like that.
Yeah.
I feel like this is a $1 million plan because I definitely wear a shirt that says "Keep it real, you're awesome."
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah.
It's my mantra.
There we go. Wonderful.
You know who else? You know who else keeps it real?
Who?
Santa Claus. That's who else keeps it real. No, I'm sorry. Shout the worst transition imaginable. But I want to talk about this movie that we all saw, right? We all did our homework. Mm-hmm. Yes. Chinny, I'm talking to you.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. Absolutely. I did. Yeah.
And so basically, to do a brief sort of description of the movie, a simple act of kindness always sparks another, even in a frozen, faraway place. When Schmiersberg's new postman, Jesper, befriends toy maker Klaus. Klaus. That's up for debate, I guess. Mm-hmm. Their gifts melt an age-old feud and deliver a sleigh full of holiday traditions. Wow, life. Yeah. Our producer and lead writer. Well done on that. That description. God. It's truly. Those aren't my words, people. Those are the work of one of our head writers.
The teleprompter is doing a good job.
So I want to open it up to you guys first before I give my gut reactions. What were your sort of initial reactions after seeing the film?
Oh. You first, Tim. Yep.
So first reaction, I already said this kind of, it's like this, it did get me excited for Christmas and for these holiday traditions that are familiar to me from my childhood. That like many traditions, as would be demonstrated in the film, you know, you learn to have different nuanced perspectives on, but still there are these nuggets of like beauty and things that are really just healthy and beneficial, I think, that are in those traditions. And like, so it made me reflect on Christmas in an overall positive way. That was one of my initial gut takeaways. Another initial gut takeaway, and this kind of goes beyond kind of the peace building sort of analysis of the film, was just like the animation was really beautiful in this film. Yeah. Like it's a really unique and creative and just overall beautiful animated feature. And I'm trying to learn to appreciate those types of things more. I feel like it's really easy. As somebody who kind of like does reviews of films or looks at those kinds of things to just say like, oh, animated is just there and it's just this thing. But like, I feel like there's this film kind of shows that there's a lot of beauty to be shown through animated feature. And then the last takeaway, sorry, I know you didn't ask for three, but I'll give you a magic number of
please,
three.
Oh,
I love this.
I would say third was just all of the more sort of deeper sort of social analysis that I took away. Which was just that I felt that this was a film that definitely plays into and plays out these very common and palatable and also, just like overall like salient social dynamics. And kind of takes them and hyperbolizes them in a lot of ways and kind of augments some of the realities that we might actually see, but it does a good job of sort of being sort of an allegory for maybe some of the conflicts that we see in our world.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I'm definitely going to echo what you said, Tim. And then I'm going to add a couple points to it. First of all, I love Christmas. I love the holidays and whatever, if you Kwanzaa, whatever you celebrate, I'm on board with that. And so movies always get me just so bubbly on the inside. But working at PeacePlayers has definitely changed my lens. And then working in Baltimore City in communities that are very underserved has definitely changed my lens. And that is, for me, the movie, along with all the points you hit, Tim, also embraced the idea of the trickle-down system, right? Where people, no matter what level you're at, you want to hold on to your power. Mm-hmm. And in this movie, it meant when we're on, they were on opposite sides and there was power there, but when they united, right, they still had power against Klaus. So it's like people always want to hold on to their power because some, in some way, on any level, whether you have all the money in the world or you have no money at all, power is a part of people's identity. And that's kind of what I walked away from the movie thinking, apart from like crying because I really loved it. But also growing up, I loved Santa Claus. And this movie, again, with this new lens and this new space that I'm in, I was like, well, I was thinking of race, right? Like, why is Santa Claus always one particular race? Like, is that how it is? Is that how Santa Claus looks universally? And so that's one of the things that I was like, okay, is Santa Claus, I was thinking of race. It's just like, okay, if my kids are growing up, they're gonna think that Santa Claus is this race. Yeah. When in actuality, I think it would have been cool if Santa Claus kind of just was all different types of races and they were going to all different types of homes and they were meet, you know, like, but that was something I was thinking about in terms of the movie. And a lot of Christmas movies are the same way.
Yeah. Yeah. And they kind of, Chinny, that's a good point you raise, because they do kind of touch upon that idea of the outsider to some extent, where yeah. it's the, I'm going to forget the girl's name, but it was like the girl who doesn't speak the same language as anybody, right. And you can't yeah. understand it. But even that, it was like blonde hair, blue eyed, white girl, like kind of mm-hmm. other, which is like, you know, a stretch to some extent, you know. And I was curious, I was thinking, I don't know, the whole notion of race in this one was interesting to me, because it seemed as though that wasn't the focal point, which isn't necessarily a bad thing, but it is yeah. something that's like, okay, maybe needs to be addressed in some form or another. There's two things about that. There's like two ways you can look at this film that I think it does justice, which is that essence of Christmas or just the holiday season, like you said, gets people bubbly and gets people joyous. And before this movie had come out, I think, like you said, Chinny, there was like this patternistic, which isn't a word. My parents will get really upset for me that I just said that. It's not a word.
It's fine.
behavior that's like, these movies are coming out and they're sort of regurgitating the same sort of ethos and like narrative plot points over and over again. And nothing seems new or fresh. And so there's the original idea I really appreciated, just in terms of telling a story in a new and refreshing idea. But it was also the technical side of things that I really appreciated it. So, you know, just some facts about it. It took 2 years to make. There was over 300 animators that were hand drawing these wow. characters. And so it was 2D, actually. Mm-hmm. It wasn't ever CGI. None of it is CGI'd at all, mm-hmm. except for maybe a few points. And it's all just through lighting that adds a depth of feel that makes 2D characters come to life. And that sort of attention to detail and sort of the connection that, you know, during Christmas or the holiday seasons, how much like lighting plays a factor in people's mood of like the light of the fire, the light of the Christmas lights, or the light of just like these warm sort of feelings that you get from light on a subjective level, but also on an emotional level, I thought played really well into generating that feeling, Chinny, that you said, which is like, I want to feel what it feels like during the holiday season. And you kind of do feel that during the movie. Do you disagree or agree? Or I'm curious your guys' thoughts on that.
I would agree. I would agree generally with that. And I think that, there's interesting like traditions with like the holidays. And I think that this film does an interesting job of like playing into and out of those aesthetics. And like right. they do, there's some interesting play there. Like you're saying with like the lighting, I think is definitely one. You know, there's not like, you don't get a lot of the stereotypical like green and red and gold and the holly and like, you know, the all that sorts of stuff. But you do get, you get it in more like kind of subtle ways. And it makes it feel, at least this is my opinion, but it kind of makes it feel like, I think, what the story sort of is. And it's like, here's this sort of new version of maybe a myth that we can have that is this is the legend of how Christmas or how Santa Claus started, right?
Right.
And so you don't get like the clear, like exactly what we have in our age of consumerism version of Christmas, but you get like this sort of archaic version of it that sort of looks like this is the origin story kind of a thing.
Right, right. But I want to take it even a step further. Sorry to interrupt him.
No,
just
go.
In terms of like the animation as a medium and just like the creativeness that comes with animation in terms of storytelling, I think adds this layer of fantastical nature to it, in terms of you can tell a story only so far when it's real people and it's in sort of a reality based setting, if that makes sense. Schmerzberg is a technically real place, but the fact that it's told through animation, it adds this sort of subconscious meaning and feeling of this sort of fantastical, creative, magical, indescribable feeling that you get, I think, also with coming on Christmas time. I remember when I was a kid and I was sort of like, my mom grew up in New York City. And so, you know, we always joke about how when she goes to New York, her like mindset shifts completely. And she's almost like a completely different person, because you just like have to be like a successful New Yorker. You just got to walk. You got to walk and like let your shoulders hit people kind of thing. And she was saying, and I was noticing as a kid, like around the holiday season, everybody just changes. Like people are like nicer,
yeah,
like commandeer, be more helpful and happier. And I was asking my mom, I was like, why are people doing that? And she was like, I don't know. There's just something, there's some fugazi, something in the air that kind of just makes people change in that area of time, you know?
And if only it were like that, right? You know, because they change, but then they change back. Like
exactly.
It'd be awesome.
Yeah.
And so it's funny that you say that, because in the beginning of the movie, I was thinking the same. Like, it's always that movie of this really rich kid who needs to be rocked down to the ground and be grounded again. And so he's sent off to like, and I was thinking, is that relatable? Because but the story, it's always like they have to be humbled and they have to know what if they don't have things. And it's interesting that it takes it there. I think most movies do, where it's just like really super, super high up and not considering anybody else. Like you said, your mom says you got to be in the street rubbing elbows with people to really like come down and be grounded and be rooted in this holiday season, because we're all here, peace and love. And then when it's over, we'll just revert back to.
Yeah, then it's back to, yeah. Hitting right, people right. and stuff like
Knock
that.
Knocking them out. Filling their wallets. So yeah, it's interesting.
No, I guess that's a good follow-up question to ask both of you is, did you find it like reactions to the movie are obviously the first gut reaction is an emotional reaction, sort of how you feel towards it on an emotional level, and then sort of a relatable level after sort of the dust settles. Did you feel as though, because I think you touch upon a pretty interesting point, Chinny, that it's a level of relatability in terms of, is this a story that people can relate to, or is it more of a story that people can just relate to on a feeling level, if that makes sense,
right.
in terms of. And so I'm curious your guys' thoughts on that.
I think that it depends. I think it depends, obviously, on the person, like the audience. Because there is a lot of moving pieces in the film. I think that like for me, I feel like there was a level of relatability to this like privileged main character Jesper, because I try to know myself well enough to know that I walk through the world with a degree of privilege, maybe not to the same sort of dramatized degree as this character does, but I know that's a part of who I am. It was almost like trying to notice sort of how that story is being told and maybe seeing like, okay, so how could I be different than this? Maybe how could I, you know, try to get to that end goal without having to go through being a jerk first, most movies will have it happen. But then there was a couple other things I thought in terms of relatability, that I think were very relatable, but also maybe weren't as much. I'll try not to talk for too long, but there's a few things I think that can be brought up here. And obviously there's, you know, the big feud, right? And I think that this type of entrenched sort of conflict obviously is very common. Peace Players is right in the thick of a lot of that. I think that a lot of that stuff is very relatable. A lot of the portrayals of the dividing lines and the differences and some of the violent rhetoric, some of the violent or conflict related traditions or norms that are thrown into the film, I think are very relatable, because those are things that a lot of communities are entrenched in. But I also think that one place where I feel like there's a little bit of an irrelatability there is that I feel like on our Earth, the majority of those conflicts do also involve a pretty significant difference in power within that society 100%. Between the two sides of the feud, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it's like in this one, you have I can't even remember the names of the families. I'm so sorry. But you have, you know, you have the...
I think it's like the Crumbs. The Crumbs, was that one?
Yes, you're just being modest. I'm sure you know the word, both. You're like, I think of the Crumbs and the...
I want to say like the Weasleys and like the Slytherins.
Yeah, we can say whatever we want.
Let's right, yeah, we can say whatever we'd like.
The audience doesn't know we haven't watched this movie, so that's the best part.
Yes, we have.
But they are... they're not portrayed in a way where it's like one of them is sort of the working class or one of them is sort of disempowered and not in in government or are not the owners of production or whatever. And I feel like in most of the cases we see in the world, that's the way it is. And mm-hmm. and so I do think that that's something that that's just a grain of salt, I think, to be ingested along with the dynamics that are portrayed in the film. Is just that this does portray ways that people can come out of conflict maybe, but most of the conflicts that we're going to be looking at in the real world that may look this way in some ways and may be able to be come out of in some similar ways are also going to be conflicts where even if the people stop hating each other, a big group of them will probably still be disempowered. And that's not a sustainable solution. That's not transformation. That's not reconciliation. And so I do think that's like a really important point about this film.
I agree.
Although, like I said, I do think that it does play out these dynamics that are very real and tangible to a really, really accurate and like a very relatable degree. Hope that makes sense.
No, that makes perfect sense. It's true. I mean, no one in conflict is on the same level. And there's always a group, especially when we are looking at where we serve for Peace Players, that's not always, but there's that oppressed group, let's say. So it's really difficult to to make amends if one group is always, like you said, disempowered and the other group, you know, like it's a hard place to get to. Not that you can't, but it's just realistically, it's not as the movie displays, like, oh, well, let's just get on the same side and be merry and happy.
Right.
I was just gonna add on to you just really briefly, Chinny. I think that it's not always like this very clear paramount. Sometimes it's, you know, one group is a colonial power or is, you know, some you know, the descendants of invaders of some kind. Or there's racial aspects to it. I think that there are labor aspects to it. And I think that's just the real world sort of and also there's gender and sexuality that is a big dynamic that exists in that as well. So that's just what I would say to kind of just add on to that.
The movie is, that's where the, as I like to call it, the Disney filter comes into play in terms of how to portray, you know, like you said, it's this even playing field conflict.
Right.
Maybe the only difference that is mentioned is that we'll call I forget the names as well. There's a woman and a guy who are sort of the leaders of the two families, right?
Of the two
and the woman is clearly portrayed as much more intelligent and more of a strategist. And then the guy is much more of like the brute strength.
Gender is
That seems the only difference in terms of like their conflict.
Right.
But in terms of like the Disney-esque thing, it's like, let's try to make it as smooth and clear for a child to right. understand what's yeah. going on to some right, degree. Right. And so I think you're right, Tim, in an umbrella way, like, oh, Ellingbo and a crumb. Thank yeah. you. That's our producer, Life. Thank right. you, Life.
That is incredibly helpful. Yes. Yeah. I knew you were right about the crumb.
Yeah, I was yeah, right about the crumb. I didn't sound like crazy.
Ellingbo is so not memorable. It's not memorable at all. So
yeah, neither is the whole movie. But yeah,
No,
the movie was good. The movie was good.
It was brilliant.
Another thing I kind of want to raise. This is what I was trying to say earlier. Because Tim, you mentioned you understanding your privilege, but it always seems like movies like this talk about privilege in an extreme way, right? And then having extreme privilege means it needs to be linked to finding a moral compass. And it seems like he has this extreme privilege, he's sent off, and now he has this beautiful moral compass. And we kind of like in these movies get rid of that privilege. We kind of sweep it under the rug until the father shows up and it's like,
Right.
Yeah.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah. It's like.
And he's in sort of a controlled environment where he can experience the lack of privilege, right?
Right.
And I think that's like a privilege thing in and of itself. It's like, you know, eat, pray, love type of privilege.
Right.
If that makes
totally.
Sense.
Totally.
So yeah, that is a really important point, I think.
Well, let me, I just wanted to finish the, like, so it's like smoothed out in terms of digestible for kids in a lot of ways, this idea and this narrative structure. But I think, and Tim, you raised this point, and we'll get into this sort of in the second half, I think in an umbrella way, the ideas and how one of the reasons we chose this was that it's so closely linked to a lot of Peace Player's mindset and methodology in terms of starting that conversation. I think we're also a little bitter to be like, what, this is a 150-year-old feud and just kids did one winter of living together and now the feud is gone and that's it. Like, we've been working friends, so long, right? You know, it's just like we're like in the real world that wouldn't happen kind of thing. But I think that idea of like starting, like the overarching idea of like you have to target the youth, you have to target the younger generations in order to sort of make irreparable change in for the better for future generations. I think that sort of ethos is still really strong and really important. And I think they did a good job of doing that to some extent.
Yeah, they did.
No, I totally agree with that. And one of the things that really stood out to me in that regard that I thought was just like very thoughtful and just like the whole basis of the film played into it really well was just the fact that like the main character is a mailman, right? I think that's really fascinating because one of the things that I've seen and I've, you know, read and noticed is just that oftentimes it's these institutions of our society that are some of the things that deteriorate in conflict and also are some of the things that can pull us out of conflict. And so for this particular film, one of the things that comes to mind is the fact that, you know, they are able to bring the postal service back to the people. And that is one of the things that sort of starts to mend the society. And then the bigger one to me is sort of the subplot, which is the education, right? I think education, kids are back in school. And the fact that when they're in conflict, they don't want their kids in school. They don't want their kids educated. I think we're seeing that right now in the US in a lot of ways. A lot of people, there's a lot of flack. A lot of flack being given to the US public school systems. Over teaching kids about racism. And so I think that that's really, really a relatable topic to this film. And so I think that that's something that we're seeing play out right now. And then we see that the education is something that naturally comes back in as the conflict starts to subside. And it also is one of the biggest things that aids them in overcoming the conflict.
I think what's so great about it is that they use, what they're doing is they're taking something and they're using power for good, right? And what I mean by that is because an institution, like we can look at the news, like they can report whatever they want, but in this case the mailman is communicating and sending positive communication throughout these two towns, I guess, two cities. And so that power for communication, he's using it, he's putting in the hands of good, and he's making sure that the you know, the stories are being communicated, the wishes are being granted, when in for example the United States, it can go either way. We can use our our institutions of communication for we could put in the power of those who probably shouldn't have it, and it can tear people apart. Or for this movie, like Disney, they're great. Let's use the power of communication to lift us all up and connect us through these lines. And so I thought that was brilliant in the sense that they really made sure that they gave us the conflict, but gave us clear definitions, or I guess lines, to how when conflict arises and we use these things for good, we use power in the direction of, I guess, just good, great things arise for kids.
Right.
So yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And we'll after our brief little lightning round, we'll dive a little bit deeper into sort of those Easter eggs that they present in the film to help us sort of understand, like you said, Tim, how do we get sort of what things need to be in place in order to execute good progressive change, and then also how many similarities to Peace Players are there in this film, because there are quite a few concrete ones and then more existential overarching ones as well. But before we do that, Chinny, can you tell our returning incredibly attractive guest what is about to happen?
Well, I'm sure you guessed it, Tim. But you have just reached the Christmas. Insert Christmas music here.
Yeah.
A lightning round.
Sleigh bells are ringing. Silver bells. I can't sing.
So simply happy.
So wonderful Christmas. So welcome to the lightning round. Of course, you know the rules, but we'll just reiterate them. And that is, you have 3 to 4 seconds to answer these questions. We will, Emmett, what will we do?
Yeah, and even though it's the Christmas spirit, we still will judge you very heavily on each one of your answers. So
perfect. That's good to know.
Emmett will ask you a series of questions, and you will, of course, be your brilliant, handsome self and answer them
in
3 to 4 seconds. No, okay. You're not.
Tim, are you ready?
Okay. No, not remotely, but let's
perfect. Yeah. Chinny, you got the clock and the sleigh bells?
Yeah, I got it. And I've got my pen just in case he drops a dime.
Just in case. Okay.
Yep.
Starting off easy. Eggnog really or easy. Cookies?
Get this right, Tim. Eggnog or cookies?
Together. Have them together. Eggnog.
Sorry, that's not allowed.
I forgot the rules. He reeled me in there. Sorry, you got to pick one or the other. Sorry.
So we're 0-1, but try again.
Okay, fine. Cookies.
Okay, Chinny, write that down. What was the last thing that made you smile?
Funny middle school kids.
Oh, nice. Shouts out them kids. Okay, holiday/Christmas music or holiday/Christmas carols?
Ooh, good one.
Music. Holiday music. Christmas music, I would say. Yeah. And I'll give a shout out to my hometown heroes, the Killers. They have an album called Don't Waste Your Wishes, original Christmas music. Excellent.
Oh, excellent.
Don't Waste Your Wishes. I'm not excellent. Sure how that's gonna
go. Are we writing that down, Chinny? Are we writing that down? Yeah.
Write it down, everybody.
Don't waste your wishes. Got it.
Sledding or skiing?
Skiing. No, sledding. Snowboarding, but sledding.
Okay. Decisive. I like it. Hot cocoa or hot cider?
Hot cider.
Really?
Interesting. Yeah. Interesting. It's gotta be. Yeah. Me and Chinny, we'll talk about that later.
It's gotta be, he said.
Okay. Tim, is Nightmare Before Christmas a Christmas movie or a Halloween movie?
A Christmas movie.
Okay.
Seriously?
I like that.
I think it's a Christmas movie.
I agree. We'll talk about it later.
We are so disconnected here. Okay. All right.
Christmas lights in a small town or snow globe dense forest? So basically what I'm asking is, do you like the small town decorated Christmas light vibe or the immense Narnia snow globe like pine wood forest?
Well, the town sounds warmer, so I'll go with the town.
Yeah. Okay. Who doesn't like lights? Yeah.
Stockings or mistletoe?
Mistletoe.
Okay.
Shouts out the misses.
Yes.
The way exactly. He laughed was like, ha, ha, he's got something to tell us later. Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Warm fire or cozy blanket?
Oh, that's easy.
The fire.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's got
Christmas gifts or Christmas decorating?
Easy.
Gifts.
Shallow, but okay.
Yeah,
I agree.
consumerist.
No, I agree. Okay, is Die Hard a Christmas movie?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, okay.
That's controversial. Sorry, everybody.
Sorry.
That's a hot take, but we'll take it. Okay, The Grinch or Ebenezer Scrooge?
Easy.
I would go with Ebenezer Scrooge. Oh, man.
Well, it is a classic. They both
are.
Chinny,
we're writing this down.
There's, I've got to rewatch The Grinch, but the depth, I'm a literature person. I love literature.
No. You don't have to justify yourself, Tim. It's okay. We judge you anyway. It's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Basically. Yeah. Okay.
Frosty the Snowman or Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer?
Easy.
Rudolph. I think.
There you go.
Yeah.
How do you get those gifts that you wanted, right?
Yeah.
You want the gifts, not the decorating. Rudolph's doing it.
Right. The stop motion short film. Come on.
Yes. There you go.
Yeah.
Another great film to check out, audience, if you haven't. The original Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer is phenomenal. Yeah.
An anti-bullying campaign.
Yeah. Thanks. It is. Tim, favorite holiday song or Christmas song?
Oh my goodness. I really like this song.
Help him.
I Saw Three Ships, if anyone knows that one.
Oh no.
No, we never heard that.
What is that?
It's like a carol. I'm not gonna sing it. But just go look it up. It's a good one. I feel like it's like a very traditional Christmas song.
Is it like caroling song or is it like commercial song?
I think it's probably a little bit more of a caroling song, but I feel like it's around in both. Maybe it's a little bit, obviously it's more of a deep,
deep dive. Three Ships, it's called? Three what?
I Saw Three Ships.
Okay.
That's
a new one. I'm excited. I was not expecting that. Favorite Christmas/holiday movie.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. This is too hard. This one's too hard.
Not that hard.
Yeah, the only way it is up.
I honestly can't even think of one, to be honest. Like, I don't even know if I do have a favorite.
Mine is really cheesy, but come on. Everybody has a favorite Christmas.
I haven't started watching Christmas movies yet. I do like A Christmas Story. I lived in Terre Haute, Indiana, where it takes place. Mm-hmm. And so I can go with Christmas Story. That's fine.
Christmas Story. Great movie.
What's yours, Emmett? Sorry, I have to stop this. Emmett, what's your favorite Christmas movie?
Oh, either How a Grinch Stole Christmas, the original animated cell one, or I'm a big Peanuts Christmas guy as well.
Oh, love it.
That one's wonderful. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
My sister's obsessed. Shouts out with my obsessed sister who loves Christmas movies. Tim, last one. One thing you want listeners to remember from today.
I would love people to remember that, we like to talk, I talk about movies and, you know, movies can be a great way to think and talk about like deeper and really, really meaningful topics. And if you want more of that, go check out my other podcast.
Plug it away. Say the title.
Which is called Pop Violence. And it's, you can find it on any, podcasting platform, as well as on Instagram at pop.violence, and it's a purple skull. And I've had Emmett and Chinny on. And I think that hopefully this conversation on this very episode resonates with the listeners. And I think that I hope that anytime I do a podcast like this, it's inspirational to people for when they're digesting media out on their own to, you know, give it some deeper thought. So that's something I think is important and also really good.
Yeah.
Wow. And with that, you know, Chinny, he was shaky throughout and then he closed it. He closed it strong. We can still talk to him. So that's okay.
Finish strong. Great job.
Well done.
All right. Wow.
You got through it.
I'm tense right now. I'm so tense.
It's fine. You're going to get those gifts because you pick gifts.
Holy cow. I'm going to need some of that kind of eggnog after this.
Yeah. I really like that you picked both because I was like, yeah, no, no. Stay focused, Chinny. Yeah. I
picked both. Eggnog and the cookies. Yeah. But Tim, before we let you go, because I know you have a tight schedule because you're super busy being hot or whatever. And I want to ask you guys sort of, so when I saw this for the first time, and we were talking to our head life producer about what sort of head producer, about what movie to watch, he recommended this one. And I had already seen it. And I was like, exactly. There are so many connections to what we do at Peace Players throughout, not just on a sort of concrete level, but even on an existential level in a lot of different ways. Mm-hmm. Concretely, we see that pretty much our mantra of children that play together learn to live together in a lot of ways, and that the children are the ones who end up mending the conflict, and it's all based around playing. That's the main thing. It's a girl and a guy, I think, whose fences opened up. That's the other concrete things. There are walls that divide these two communities.
Right.
We see that in Peace Players in Northern Ireland. We see that in the West Bank. We see that in Cyprus. And even more like what Tim, you were mentioning earlier, is the stress on education and how much educating the youth is sort of the antidote and sort of foundations for creating everlasting change in a positive way. And so I'm curious, what were your guys' thoughts? And also, do you have any other sort of morsels or sort of hors d'oeuvres of stuff that you saw that resonated with you that connected to Peace Players in some way? Chinny, I'll start with you.
I think, Emma, you made a really great points there. And I wanna just, actually, I'm gonna toss it back to Tim, but one of the things that the movie did a really great job of, and I think that we're doing in Peace Players in a way, is that oftentimes we hold on to these cultural traditions that sometimes tear down the actual culture. I mean, tear down the group of people who we're actually trying to hold on to these traditions for. And I think the movie does a really good job of, like, I remember there was a part in the movie where the the two young people kissed each other and like, he kissed her. It was like this big, because culturally that's not what they did, right? Like culturally it was normal to hang on to the conflict. And I think what we're doing in Peace Players, we're not necessarily tearing culture, the bad aspects of culture down, but we're saying, hey, look at this. This might be something you've done culturally, but look at use the right lens, right? That inside outside transformation. Is this really adding value to the people that are practicing this culture? And is it inclusive of others? And so I think the movie does a really, really good job of showing us what the destruction of culture in the sense of holding on to things that don't serve us can do, and how letting go of that actually helps us create a far more inclusive culture that can bring everyone into like who we are and how we grow as people. So I don't know if that makes any sense.
No, and also that it's a domino effect in a lot of ways, one act of kindness, like they say at the beginning, sparks another. That's what Klaus says. And so that's just like the ethos of the film. And a lot of what we do at Peace Players is just like, if you see what it is that we're doing, trust me, and you have a heart, you will want to do the same thing, kind of.
Absolutely. Right.
Yeah. I think those are really wonderful connections. I would definitely echo those. And obviously I'm not entirely as familiar with Peace Players even as you two are, being, you know, a big part of the operations. But I would say, like, something that jumped out to me going off of what you just said, Chinny, was when the leader of the clan or whatever takes the young person who had been playing with the frog, kind of like behind the curtain sort of a thing. And it's like, look at all these tokens of our, and they use the phrase tradition, our beloved tradition of hate. And I think that, like, probably none of our cultures would say it that way. But I think that all of our cultures have that, right? Like, I think even for me, like, I tried to think when I watched this, like, what are some ways that I grew up with these really glorified, romanticized imagery that was really just a cover for violence or conflict or hatred? And so I think that Peace Players is in the effort of trying to dismantle those types of narratives that are so prevalent. And related to that as well, I think, and I feel like this is something that is probably seen in Peace Players, and I feel like is one of the reasons why it's so important to work with youth, is that there's the part where, you know, that the kids encounter each other, they're a little sheepish at first, but they get along.
Right.
But then it's the parents. Once the parents see that, they're like, this can't happen.
Right.
And the resistance from the parents, I think, is something that makes sense and can be dangerous for the kids. The kids get punished for it.
Right.
I think that's something to acknowledge. And then the last thing I'll say that I think maybe hasn't been mentioned, that I think is something that Peace Players does that I love, that I think happens in this film, is really what this film is about, is it's about giving things like material things or material opportunities to people that don't have them. Mm-hmm. And that is something that brings them together, brings them out of a conflict mindset, brings them into a less sort of violent approach to their society. And so I do think that that's something that's really important. And like, if you study conflict and war, we know that poverty and violence follow each other.
Right.
Everywhere they go. Mm-hmm. And so giving people things, giving people opportunities, giving people resources. And so I think that Peace Players does that in the way where this film, they're giving toys. Peace Players gives a game to people that maybe don't have access to go and play that game and to be in that space and to have those really positive enriching experiences. And so that's another thing that I would say, I would point to, is like Peace Players is sort of playing this role or trying to play this role in communities.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And Emmett, I just want to add that this piece, and you said people, but I want to say youth. They're give by providing material opportunities to youth who don't necessarily have that hate culture buy-in already, right? They are in position to be swayed. They are in position to have their lenses changed a bit. And I think that's what makes it so powerful. And what's so great about these movies is that what they do is they give youth the opportunity, these opportunities, material opportunities, and they take it and they essentially can change the world. And that's what Peace Players does, right? We provide these equitable opportunities through peace, through this game. And we're saying like, look, here's an opportunity. And I think what's instinctively natural for kids is to take it and say, I want to do something good with it. And they may not know that they're changing the world, but kids are just naturally like inclined to be like, no, actually I want to make friends. I don't want to do what my parents are telling me to do because it's supposed to be our, hate traditions or cultures. I like this kid. He's awesome. He's amazing.
Yeah.
And yeah, so.
Totally.
Yeah. Brilliant. And
Tim, I know you have a modeling gig that you have to get to. And so I appreciate you.
Unfortunately.
Taking the time. To talk with us and our audience. If you're listening and you're with your loved ones this holiday season or your family, go on Netflix if you have access to that, watch Klaus, or just enjoy being with your loved ones and your family. From everybody at the Play It Forward podcast, Tim and Pop Violence, we wish you a happy holiday and a happy new year.
And that's it for today's episode. Thank you all for listening and joining us on this amazing holiday journey. Mm-hmm. If you like what you heard, you know, I always say like and subscribe, but most importantly, we encourage you to invite a friend, ask people to listen to the conversation, join the conversation, extend the conversation past what you've heard and really bring it home to people who wouldn't be around to hear this, or share every one of our episodes with your friends.
Every single one.
Or leave a review like Dan Grunfeld did for us, who says, thank you, Chinny and Emmett. The interview was amazing. And Peace Players International is an amazing organization. I hope to do it again. Thanks, Dan. Dan was on our show earlier and he was, I'll go with the flow, amazing. Leave a comment, leave a review, we love it. Emmett, your thoughts?
Yeah, check out his episode if you haven't already, episode 2, By the Grace of the Game. And Tim, you know, he's an old friend, he's an old soul at this point. He's some would say he's good looking, I don't know who, but some would say, and you know, he embodies sort of that jolly holiday spirit, so it was really nice to have him on. I enjoyed talking to him. You can learn more, Chinny. Did you know this, Chinny, that you could learn more about PeacePlayers by visiting our website at www.peaceplayers.org and following us on social media at Play It Forward Podcast and at PeacePlayers International on, I think it's Instagram. I'm correct. I think it's Facebook. I'm also correct.
Absolutely.
I know it's Twitter. I'm correct. And LinkedIn as well, and YouTube at Peace Players International. You can also find us on MySpace, LimeWire, Tumblr.
Oh my God, that was a new one.
LimeWire is a new one. Bonus episode, you know. You can't find us on any of those three. Please don't check. And again, happy holidays from Play It Forward Podcast, and have a great Happy New Year.